What is going on, everybody? Hope everybody's enjoying their summer. Hope you guys are staying safe, getting out there and doing all those things that we couldn't do a year ago because we were all stuck at home. If you're new to my channel, welcome. My name is Black Apino, the Apple Guy. Today, I thought it was about time that I did a five-month review on this. This is my newest Sony camera. This is the Sony A6400. Now, this isn't my first Sony camera, as the ZV-1 was actually my first camera. This is my second camera that I bought about a month later after the ZV-1. And the reason why I did that was I was looking for a second camera to kind of complement, just like I had my Panasonic lineup where I had the G7 and the GD5. But I was looking for my second camera to have interchangeable lens capabilities. Obviously, with the Canons out there, they were pretty decent, but nothing that they had really stuck with me. And so I did a little bit of research in terms of just what would be the best in terms of bang for buck. And the A6400 seemed to pop up a lot on a lot of YouTubers' channels, so I thought I would give it a try, and I've had it ever since then. I did a review on it back in February, so I guess you can say it's like my kind of after review, my 5 month review, and I love this camera. So I bought the camera body only for $900, and then I bought a 16mm f2.8, which is a Sony lens, on its own for, I think it was normally like $250 or $300. I actually bought it on sale. I got actually at an open box special. I think it was like $180 or $190. It was like, I saved like $50 or $60. And it was an amazing lens. And so I loved it so much that I actually bought another lens. I actually bought two different lenses after the 16 to 50 millimeter. I bought the Sigma 30mm f1.4, and then I also bought the Sigma 16mm f1.4, which I did a review on both of those as well. So what drew me to the A6400 was the fact that it was small, lightweight, and had the same features that you'd find in a lot of other cameras, double the price. So you can buy this with the kit lens for about $1,000, and that's the 16 to 50mm kit lens. But for me, I don't like buying cameras where it comes with just a kit lens and then I have to spend more money on another lens. I usually just buy the camera first and then I look at other lenses that are going to be decent for what I do. And I'm not really big into all these huge, you know, 50mm, 75 to 200mm. That's not the kind of lenses I prefer. I kind of prefer just your simple prime lenses that are like, you know, 50 or 25 or 35. And so you can buy this with the 16 to 50mm and only about $100 more than the body itself, but I decided to go against that and just bought this along with the 16 to 50mm, and or I'm sorry, not the 16 to 50, the 16mm f2.8, and it was a great combo, and then that's kind of how I bought my other lenses. So what I love about this is it does have the ability to have the flip up screen, which is cool because, again, when you're a solo creator like myself, when you're doing yourself your videos and you want to frame yourself in shot, you want to make sure that you have your white balance set okay, your shutter balance, you want to make sure that your aperture is all correct and your white balance and all of that, because you won't usually be able to tell what it's like until after you've already made the video. Then you see all these different minor corrections that you have to make in post-edit. And if you've never edited videos before, it can be kind of a nuisance. So I usually would recommend, if you're looking at a camera, whether it's a Sony, a Canon, a Panasonic, or Fuji, whatever, at least get something with the ability to have your screen flip up so that you can at least see yourself in the video. So that is one of the things I love about this camera. And it's a pretty simple camera to use. You have all your functions right there. That's going to be your mode selector right there. And then you have right here, you have your menu functions, your function. This is going to be your focus, autofocus, depending on the type of lens that you're using. It can be like your, that'll be your focus lock, little drop thing in the middle. This is your selector function for like changing out your ISO or your aperture or your white balance, depending on how you want to set it. And then you can access all that also via shortcuts, as you can see on the sides of it. Now you put your SD card and your batteries kind of on the bottom there. Now that's probably one of two things that I don't know why they did that. On my GD5, you had the ability to slide your SD card on the side as opposed to on the bottom. Not saying that it's a bad thing on this, it's just that if you have it on a tripod, you can still have access to it if you have a quick release. But if you don't have it on a tripod and you're kind of just doing your daily vloggings and you want to swap it out, it's a pain to kind of have to, you know, stop pop it open like this, push that out, and then pop in another one, and then it's just a minor thing. I just really would have wished they would have kind of popped it on the side, to me at least. And the only other issue I have is, for some reason, they still have to put these little metal ring things with little flippy things on it. I find it extremely annoying, especially when it comes to just wanting to carry it around or doing any type of vlogging. The chattering of the chains against the body, you do notice it. It's not as loud, but you do notice it when you're doing your audio check. It's annoying. I don't know why they do that. I don't know why camera companies do that. I can understand people wanting to do the whole strap thing, but I really wish they had a better way of, you know, kind of doing that. But other than that, though, the hot shoot is probably about the only challenging thing that you're going to have for this camera. So as I said before, when you're doing your flipping your screen up, that's going to get in the way of your screen. As you can see, anything that I put in there would get in the way of that. So to alleviate that issue, you simply can just buy these things by small rig, which is what I have attached to my A6400, and then attach it to those little bars where your straps would go. Now you have a hot shoot right there and a hot shoot right there, and you can flip that up, and then that pretty much solves that issue. Now it doesn't have any type of 5-axis gimbal for you to stabilize your videos, but it does have an OSS feature, or it does have Steady Shot. So basically what that means is that it's kind of an electronic version of optical Steady Shot that you would normally get in like your higher end full frame cameras that Sony makes. But if you get a lens from Sony or any other brand that gives that option, such as OSS is what it's called for the Sony cameras, it's called optical Steady Shot, then at least you'll have a gimbal feature in the lens, and then the body can kind of compensate for that. It's not bad. I actually don't really use it as much, because most of the time when I'm doing any type of vloggings, it's just talking heads. But if I am out and about, I will usually try to use my 16 to 50 millimeter, because it does have OSS. Now it also has a host of connections and features that are host of connections that you'll actually want to use. So as you can see on the side here, you've got your 3.5 millimeter jack. That is what you would use to plug in any type of external devices, such as your mics. I use a Rode wireless mic, so I just simply just plug it into that. Then in the center here, as you notice, that's going to be your micro USB to USB. That is what you would use to plug into the computer, and you can either charge the camera, or you can do direct. You can pull your photos directly from the camera with the connection in up here. This is the one that usually I find the more relevant in terms of connection-wise, next to the 3.5 millimeter jack. This is your mini HDMI to HDMI. Now, what does that mean? That means that you can basically turn this camera into a webcam. You simply just have to go out, buy a micro HDMI to HDMI, connect it to your PC or to your Mac via an adapter if you have a newer Mac. And then you would simply download software, whether it be, I think it's Sony's Mirror Edge or Web Edge, I think it's what it's called, and that allows you to turn this camera into a webcam for, say, your live videos, for like whether it's just your Zoom or for Facebook Live or even for YouTube Video Live. It's very useful. I don't think I've used it yet on this camera, but I have done it on my Sony ZV-1, and this has a clean HDMI out. So basically what that means is that when you're turning on your camera and you get a host of all these little numbers and stuff on the side that says like your shutter speed, what aperture, f1.5, and your ISO and all that, typically when you connect this to a monitor, it's going to show all that information on your screen transfer to your monitor. But if you select clean HDMI out, it literally removes all those numbers and all the distractions on the screen from the monitor, so all you get is just straight video. It's actually pretty cool. I highly recommend it when it comes to using this for your YouTube Video Lives or for your Facebook Lives or for Zoom Live meetings. You just simply just pop it on a tripod and boom, there you go. It is lightweight. It's not heavy as you'd expect the camera to be. It's got this nice grip on the side. It's easy to grip. So even if I were to attach like my Sigma 16mm, which is not on here now, this is my 30mm, even though the lens is bigger than both this lens and the camera together, it's still not heavy enough to where it's fatiguing, where you're feeling like you're carrying around a rock in one hand. It's pretty simple to use, and I would recommend it to anybody who's looking to buy their first Sony camera. It's an amazing camera. I have a link in the description down below if anyone wants to take a look at the kit, the body and kit for this. Again, It's an amazing camera. I paid $8.99 for the body, and then I spent another $100+ for a separate lens, but that's just what I wanted to do. But you can buy this in a kit, this and the 16-50mm, for about $1,000, which is actually pretty good. It's actually less than what I paid for mine body alone, which is $900, and then adding an extra separate lens, I've actually spent $100 more than the kit lens. But it's definitely worth it if you're looking to buy your first Sony camera. It has amazing picture quality. I'll throw some pictures up at the end if you want to take a look at them. They're not really edited or anything. They're just straight pictures that I use with the Sigma 16mm. So I want to thank everybody for watching this video. And again, if you're new to my channel, don't forget to smash that subscribe button. Hit the bell notification. That way you don't miss content when I drop it. And again, I want to thank everybody for watching. And my name is Black the Apple Guy. And I'll see you guys in the next video.